Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I love everyone visiting. Let's stand up and worship to God together. Hang on just a second.
Now we're ready?
There we are. Yes, sorry.
Father God, we come into your presence today. Father, it is with joy that we come together. It is with expectation that we come together. And Father, it is an honor and a privilege to gather together as the body of Christ. Father, I thank you and I praise you this day And we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 It is great to see everyone this morning. A couple of announcements. First of all, September, I think this is the month of September, last somebody told me. And that means it is rummage sale month. Yeehaw, everybody's excited, right? If you are interested in putting a sign in your yard or in somebody else's yard, please see Carol Peck and Paul. The one thing we are asking, if you take a sign and put it in your yard or somebody else's, if when the rummage sale is over, if you would bring it back. I was shocked. I found out these are not free. Can you believe that? We actually have to pay for these. So if you'd like to take one, see Carol Peck and Paul. But we do ask that you bring it back. A couple other announcements. Along with the rummage sale, there's a sign up for desserts. Did you hear that? Desserts? Yeah. Desserts. Also, this Saturday, we are serving breakfast at the United Caring Shelter. We show up at 8. We serve at 9, and by 9:30, we're out of there. If you can help, we would love to have that help. Also, this Tuesday, a rummage sale meeting. Wednesday, church chicks. We have a new Bible study starting in a week and a half on the 13th. And also, Darren's, he'll be here in the second service, I think. Darren has a birthday today, so we want to sing to Darren a little later. Also today, Don and Joanne Utley, on Friday, right? On Friday, 2 days ago, they celebrated 68 years of marriage. 68 years. Don and Joanne are at home, but they're watching the service online. I got to tell you, Don and Joanne are two of my favorite people. They just are. Two of my favorite all-time people in 68. Can anybody here beat 68 years of marriage? You're not 68, so Don and Joanne, they're our winners. So this morning, as you meet and greet, look around. If you see somebody and you think that they're either at least 68 years of age or they've been married 68, or they look like they've been married 68 plus years.
If anybody comes up to
say, greet them and so anyway, let's meet and greet today.
Thank you.
seat. I have to tell you a little story about this song. For those of you who have ever sang with me when I play, you realize that, one, I go way too fast most of the time. Right, Kurt Buck? Mm-hmm. And this is Kurt Buck's favorite sign language to me when we're singing. Would you like to stand up and show them what your favorite sign language is? He pulls back on those reins. Then there are some songs that I can sing and I can't play, or I can play and I can't sing because of the syncopation of it, which I know is a really $20 word, but this song is one of those syncopated I can't sing the songs, because Kim has this lovely piano piece. I can't play it on the right beat for anything, and if I play it and sing it, I'm gonna mess something up big time. So by the grace of God, we get through that song. But that song in so many ways is about life. How many times do you feel like you're just off of everything else that's going on around you? It's like we're trying to swim in mud and murk. It's just not, you're not feeling like you're getting anywhere. But that's okay, because by the grace of God, we get from here to there, even if we're not syncopated with everything that's going on in the world. And that's okay, because we are called to be set apart. We are called to not go with the beat and the syncopation of the world. We're called to go with God's beat. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the reminders, the sometimes gentle reminders and sometimes not so gentle reminders, that we are not called to be in rhythm with the world. We are called to be in rhythm and in step with you. And Lord, I thank you so much for all of you do and all that you provide for us, because your grace and your mercy are such a gift to us, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, for the reminder that it is all about you, dear Heavenly Father. It is truly all about you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that'll bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for song in is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, to the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. It's all about you, all about you, Jesus. In an endless way, no one could express how much you deserve. Song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, to the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. It's all about you.
all about you, all about you. It's all about you, all about you.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so very much for the reminder in this world that we live in that it is truly all about you. Amen. This is on page 74 in the Majesty Hymnal if you want to follow along.
Susie used the word syncopation. Syncopation. Do you ever, and I'm racking my brain this morning. So if you're not syncopated, are you unsyncopated, missyncopated, or just not syncopated? Which one is it? What is it? Not synchronized. How many of you are not synchronized this morning? How many of you, the battery is dead and there's no time at all? I'll be honest, I'm struggling a little bit this morning. Susie and I took off Friday night after the game and drove up to Indianapolis, and then after a couple hours of sleep, drove up to Notre Dame yesterday with a side trip to Michigan City, and went to the game yesterday, and we got in late last night. As we pulled into the garage last night, Susie made the comment. She said, "We're getting too old for this." So I am off a little bit this morning, so I apologize in advance. Today is Holy Communion, I did not get volunteers, but as I look out here, I see Aaron and Karen and Jack and Susan, and I think you four would be perfect to serve communion today if the four of you would help with that. I appreciate that. We are doing intinction, where you tear off a piece of the bread and dip it into the cup. If you're not comfortable with that, to my left, we have the individual servings. And for those that need gluten-free, we have that to my right. As we go to God in prayer today, I ask your prayers for David Gaines. He's in the hospital. Debbie Goff has been in the hospital. She is at home, but certainly in need of our prayers. So I ask your prayers for Debbie. Austin Myers is in the hospital. Ask your prayers for Austin. Becky Carnahan has asked for prayer, as we did last week, for her neighbor, Beryl. So we lift Beryl up in prayers this morning. Ask your prayers for Robert France. He has some health situations, and also his granddaughter. Ask your prayers. Also, Janice Peckinpah has, in the last few months, made some new friends, Bill and Betty Felcher. And Bill passed away early this morning. So I ask your prayers for Betty and for the family. Several of them, I know they're kind of spread out. I know there's some coming in or have come in from South Carolina. The funeral will be later this week. So I ask your prayers for Betty Felcher and the family during this time. If you have prayer concerns, if you lift them up this morning, thank you. Let's pray. Father God, we do come to you this morning. Father, we thank you. We praise you. And Father, I pray for, Father, we pray for Rick and Denise as they are traveling home this morning today. Good part of today they'll be traveling. And Father, I pray your safety and protection upon them. Father, we thank you for this trip that they've been able to have with their family. Father, we thank you. And Father, for those that we've lifted up this morning. Father, there is a need for the divine presence of Jesus Christ. For Jesus to reach out and to touch. And Father, we're asking for that this morning. Father, we celebrate with Don and Joanne on 68 years of marriage. Father, what a blessed union that has been. And Father, we celebrate with them. And Father, I pray your presence in their lives. I pray that their home is filled with the very Spirit of God. Father, we love you. Father, the bottom line, we just love you, Father. And Father, we thank you that you have placed each other into our lives. Father, as we journey along on this journey of faith, Father, there are times when we're the ones pushing, and there's times when we're the ones being pushed. There are times when we are carrying, and there are times when we get to do the carrying. But Father, you have placed us in each other's lives. And Father, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. This image of being carried and then sometimes carrying. Yesterday, as Susie and I and Andrew and Andrea and Addie and Ava, we were up at Notre Dame. And we walked 10,000 miles on the campus of Notre Dame. And then we walked and walked and walked and walked and walked to the very top of Notre Dame Stadium. And I'm thinking, Ava is going to be 3 next week. You think she can carry me? Because I'm ready to climb onto her back and let her carry me. I was wearing out. And when we left, there was a moment in time when Ava allowed her daddy to carry her. And that doesn't happen very often. And Ava actually just kind of laid out in Andrew's arms. And Andrea made the comment. She said, Ava never does that. I mean, she just was like a wet rag, just limp. She was so tired. And we're walking to this parking lot that I think was 4 miles away. And all of a sudden, Ava jumped out of Andrew's arms and she was walking with me. We're bringing up the rear. But she's walking. And I'm like, Ava, do you want me to carry you? And she said, nope. And she took off running. And I'm like, where in the world does that girl get that energy? That's life. There are times when we are the ones that are carrying other people. And what a privilege that is. And it took me a long time to understand and to appreciate those periods of time in our life when we are the ones that are being carried and pushed. And there are times when we have the privilege of carrying and pushing someone else. And there are so many different layers of what I'm talking about right now, but that is a part of our life. On one hand, we live the Christian life as an individual. Every one of us is going to stand before Jesus as an individual. And yet, on the other hand, we have the privilege as the body of Christ. That's one reason why we are told to not forget to assemble together. There is strength in the body of Christ that we can encourage one another. We can speak to one another. We can speak words of wisdom to one another. And that's one reason why it is so important that we worship together. That we can bear one another's burdens. This morning I want to talk about 2 individuals. And I have a feeling that these are 2 individuals that you've heard of. Some of you are going to know these 2 individuals very well. Some of you might say, you know, I think I've heard them, but I'm not completely sure who they are. When we talk about the giants of Scripture, people always talk about Abraham and Elijah, and they talk about Moses and the Apostle Paul and Simon Peter. They are the giants of the faith, and praise God for them. But there are some other giants of the faith that maybe just aren't as well known. I want to start this morning by reading from Exodus chapter 17. Exodus chapter 17, and I want to start with verse 8. Then Amalek, again, this is Exodus 17, verse 8. Then Amalek came and fought against Israel at Rephidim. So Moses said to Joshua, see, there again, we know who Moses is, we know who Joshua is. So Moses said to Joshua, choose men for us and go out, fight against Amalek. Tomorrow I will station myself on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand. And Joshua did as Moses told him and fought against Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. So it came about when Moses held his hand up that Israel prevailed. And when he let his hand down, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy. Then they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other. Thus his hands were steady until the sun set. I read this and my mind goes to Moses and to Joshua. If I'm a little kid and I'm reading this, I'd want to be Moses, the great man. I'd want to be Joshua. When I was a kid, I thought of myself as Joshua, the warrior. Somebody has to go out and fight. That's me. Put me in. Put me in. I'll fight. I want to go out and fight that battle. I want to go out and whip somebody. That's my hero. I don't know about who your heroes are, but mine were Moses and Joshua. I have a third hero in this, and that's the staff. Remember? God said to Moses, take your staff and throw it down, and it became a serpent. And then God said, Moses, pick it up. And I'm like, really? Pick up that snake? And he picked it up, and it turned back into the staff. And what did Moses do with that staff? Well, he touched the water, and it turned to blood. I want a staff like that. And he touched the water, and it turned back into water. I want a staff like that. And when Pharaoh said, take your people and go, and Moses held up that staff, and he said, onward, Christian soldiers, and they started singing that. That's wrong. And they got to the Red Sea, and what did Moses do with that staff? I want a staff like that. If I can't be Moses or Joshua, I want to be the big stick. What? I mean, to me, those are the heroes of the story. Those are the ones we focus on. But who are these other two guys? Yeah, think about these two guys. Think about them. Aaron and Hur. Excuse me. Aaron was the brother of Moses, the older brother of Moses. The older brother who was, in some respects, superseded by his little brother. It was Aaron, the older brother, who had to take a back seat to his little brother, Moses. It was Aaron who collected some gold jewelry and created a golden calf. And if I remember correctly, when Moses came down that mountain, he was not very happy with his big brother. And yet, when the battle was on, and it was Moses' job as lifting up his hands, that was the presence of God. And when Moses got tired, it was big brother Aaron and some guy named Hur that went and got him a rock to sit on. Sometimes we need a stool, a chair to sit on. Sometime in our life, once, twice, four, five times, we need somebody to help us and give us some rest. And who was Hur? Well, when you read through the scriptures, you find a couple of things about Hur. In Exodus 24, we're told that Hur was a judge. That's a position of honor and prestige. And in in Numbers 31:8, we read that Hur was the king of Midian. So who was Hur? He was a judge. He was a king. Positions of honor and respect and authority. And yet in this situation, when Moses, holding up his hands, and the Israelites were victorious, and when he got tired, they started to lose. And so I don't know if Moses looked at Aaron and Hur and said, boys, I need some help here, or if Aaron and Hur just were aware of it. I can play that out in my mind either way. But the bottom line is, Aaron and Hur stepped up and performed something that maybe does not have a lot of prestige. They could have considered it below themselves to do that. They could have thought, you know what? That's not my job. Get somebody else to do that. Get somebody else to hold up his hands. I mean, who does Moses think he is after all? Does he think he's a servant of God? What's the story here? I don't want to stand here and hold up his hands. I have more important things. They didn't do that. Aaron and Hur stood on either side of Moses and they supported him. So let me ask you this morning. In your life, at various times, you have been Moses. At various times in your life, you have been in a position of authority, of responsibility, of there was something you had to do. And there have been times when it got lonely. There have been times when you became tired. I think of all of the things that go on in this church, and there are times for every single person that has ever had any responsibility. And there are times, I'm sure, when you've thought, why am I doing this? Am I the only one doing this? And I do it all the time, and I get, for example, and you don't even have, don't answer, but Communion Sunday. Who sets up communion every month and has done it for years? Somebody does that, and it's not me. And they do it for three services. That person could easily at some point say, you know what? I get tired of doing this. I go to the store, I get the bread and the juice, and then I have to go up and down the steps for three services, and nobody ever says a word to me. Nobody ever thanks me. Wouldn't it? We all have been in those kind of positions. All kinds of jobs around this church. All kinds of things. And sometimes people just get a little tired. serving breakfast at the shelter. Well, who's in charge of that? Who makes sure that we have everything that we need? Who makes sure that we have... How long have they been doing it? Sometimes we're the Moses. We're the one doing things. And sometimes our job is to be Aaron and Hur. And to look around and to see somebody that's taking a deep breath and saying, oh, I'm getting a little tired of this. I'm wearing out. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. And sometimes we, all of us, we're to be Aaron or Hur. Sometimes that's our job. Since I became a Christian at 16, there have been times when I've been in a leadership position. And there have been more times when it was my responsibility to be Aaron or Hur. And there have been times when I was supposed to be Aaron or Hur, and I was too busy doing something else, and I didn't even notice when Moses' hands grew tired, and I wasn't there to encourage and support because I was too wrapped up in my own little life, because I have that disease we all have called me-itis, inflammation of the self. Globe head, we think the world revolves around us. I've been there, and then sometimes later, I sit back and I'm like, oh my goodness gracious, so-and-so's doing this and doing that, and I've never encouraged them. I've never given them a little bit of support, and that's my problem. I look at her and I think, what an untold hero of the scriptures. The one of the untold heroes of the scriptures. Second person, I know you're thinking, you've already talked about Aaron and her. We're really only talking about her. The second person I want to talk about this morning is one that many of you are going to go, oh yeah, well, I know about Barnabas. Barnabas is known as what? One person. I thought more of you would know this. Let's turn to Acts chapter 4. The book of Acts chapter 4. Verse 36. Acts 4:36. Now Joseph, a Levite of Cyprian birth, who was also called Barnabas, by the apostles, which translated means son of encouragement. Barnabas wasn't even his name, that was his nickname. And he was given that nickname by the apostles. Now see, most of us can name the 12 apostles, and we put them up on a pedestal. Jesus himself, to a certain extent, placed those 12 apostles on a pedestal. And yet, those 12 men looked to Barnabas. It wasn't even his name. And they gave him that nickname. You could just hear those 12 apostles talking. Guys, man, there's times it gets tired. Guys, there's times when I go out to preach and you know, what would have happened if Billy Graham would have had a crusade and he gave an altar call and George Beverly Shea started singing, just as, come on people, hang with me, George Beverly Shea singing, just as I am, and they gave the altar call and nobody came forward. What would you have said to Billy Graham backstage? Well, that was a dud. You were off your game tonight, big boy. Maybe you need to pray a little more, Billy. Wow, what a waste. It's spent all that money and rented this stadium and nobody came forward. We're going to do this again, big boy? Or would you have encouraged Billy? Think about the apostles. Jesus has ascended. Those men are going out spreading the good news. You know there were times when nobody responded. You know there were times when they were down in the dumps. You know there were times when they were just totally discouraged. And it was Barnabas who came along and lifted them up. It was Barnabas who encouraged them. It was Barnabas. Remember the story? I think Kenny Rogers sang a song about this guy. This kid, the little kid who kept throwing the baseball up and swinging and he kept missing, right? You know the story? Didn't Kenny Rogers sing a song about that? The what? I am the greatest. And he kept throwing the ball up and swinging and missing, throwing the ball up, swinging and missing. Now, most of us would have said as a little kid, boy, I'm horrible at baseball. I can't hit a pitch for anything. But what did that little boy do? He said, wow, I must be the greatest pitcher ever. When we see somebody striking out, do we look at them and say, boy, you're horrible at baseball? Or do we say, wow, you're a really good pitcher? How easy is it to look at somebody and say, boy, you really stink at that? I mean, really, how easy is it to look at somebody and say, boy, you tried to do such and such, and that didn't turn out very good? Or to take that little extra effort and find something to encourage about them. As a teacher, I can tell you there were some students that were so easy to encourage, and I can also tell you there were some students that I had to really search for something positive to say. But do you think that makes a difference? You think it makes a difference? Or the athlete that's not really an athlete? Or the singer who's not really a singer? When I was in the eighth grade, we had a choir teacher come to our school and they had tryouts for the choir. And it was during math class. So what did every boy in the eighth grade class do? I go to choir tryouts. I get out of math class. Every boy made it except one. You know what she said to me? Try again next year.
That was the most positive thing
she could say. I was an eighth grader. There was no next year, at least at grade school. Try again next year? Wow. I had to go back to math class. Now, did I want her to lie and say, boy, you're really good? No, absolutely not. That would have just set me up and everybody else up for some really bad times. But could there have been something positive to say? Wow. So let me ask you this morning. Can you be a her? Can you be a Barnabas? We know the answer, correct? Every one of us can be an Aaron, a her, a Barnabas. You know, you think about Barnabas, he was not one of the 12. He did not make the team. Barnabas did not make the team. And yet he was still there to encourage the 12 that did make the team. He could have just sat around and cried all day long. Said, I didn't get picked. I'll go do something else. I didn't get picked. I don't want anything to do with that. I'll just sit at home and play with my thumbs on those video games. I didn't get picked. I'm a nobody. Barnabas could have done that real easy. But instead, he was out there encouraging. Let's be an encourager. Let's be. If we can't be Moses, if we can't be Joshua, if we can't be the big stick, then let's be her and support and encourage those that are. As we celebrate Holy Communion this day, we know that on the night that he is betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he blessed that bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you. And likewise, he took the cup and he gave thanks over the cup. And he said, this is my blood of the new covenant. And he's talking about being an encourager. Talking about his blood. And Jesus said, I've so looked forward to this. For the forgiveness of your sins. If you'll come forward, please. If our musicians will come forward, please. All has been made ready. Starting from the back, will you come? Father God, we thank you. Father, we love you. We worship you. And Father, we give you thanks and praise today. Oh, Father, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.